Grace and peace, grace and peace, grace and peace to you, friends, and good morning. My name is Brett Swanson, pastor of Wauwatosa Presbyterian Church, and we are very glad you are joining with us for worship today. I say welcome to you, and I say as we have each and every Sunday that indeed all are welcome here at Wauwatosa Presbyterian Church. Thank you for joining us. Today on this Baptism of the Lord Sunday, we launch our all-church, all-year initiative 2021. We are one body, many members. We're going to explore this today in the story of John baptizing Christ there in the River Jordan and how we are called to find our true oneness, not in anything other than the truth that there is one God, one Lord, one baptism. So I'm glad that you're here with us as we explore this together. I say a special welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us by phone. You can call 414-253-8521 and hear an audio version of this exact service uploaded every Sunday morning. I hope that you'll share this number with those who are looking for a worship experience but don't have a stable internet connection. Now today, if you're worshiping with us before 10 a.m., you can log on to our Deacon's Coffee Hour that takes place via Zoom at 10 a.m. That will be a lot of fun. My family has a blast. I also want to point out that starting this week, we will resume our Wednesdays at 10 Bible study with a new exploration entitled Finding Joy When It Stinks. It's Paul's letter to the Philippians, and Paul writes this letter in jail, and yet he's concerned about how to foster joy in our own lives through the lens of our faith. We're going to start on January 13th, and we're going to go until Ash Wednesday, and we'll take place at 10 a.m. But I do want to say a special petition to those of you who find Wednesdays at 10 untenable. We have a little bit of interest for folks who might enjoy a Sunday morning Bible study. If you would like to participate, please contact me or the church office. If we get a groundswell of folks together, then we will feature a Sunday morning Bible study. Well, also on the 13th, Grace Circle is starting up for this season. We look at grace, not perfection. That's their motto, and that will take place at 7 p.m. If you want more information or to get the contact links, please contact Julie Badziong, either here in the church office or in the email you can find in your morning announcements. I want to say as we look forward down the counter, January 24th, we will install our church officers during worship. And then on January 31st, not only will we celebrate the joining of our confirmation kids, but we will also, after the service at 10 a.m., hold our annual meeting. All members are invited to attend. Well, friends, I'm excited to be with you as we begin our 2021 initiative. Friends, let us worship God.
Please join me in prayer. God, who spoke words of love for Jesus at his baptism, and who yet speaks words of love for us, be present with us, we pray. Speak to us anew this day, that we may speak boldly of you in a world that longs to be recreated in your love. Amen. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased."
Think of what my God can do. know he will deliver you.
Trust and never doubt, Jesus will surely bring you up. Be never failure. I will sing of God's mercy. Every day, every hour, he gives me power. I will sing and give thanks to thee.
Well, friends, I'm not a woodworker. No stretch of the imagination could you call me such. But I absolutely love wasting time on the internet watching woodworking videos. They make it all look so easy. You know, measure here, cut there, glue these pieces, clamp them down, let them dry, sand them, and you know, at the end of the video, they have a headboard or end table or this fancy cutting board I couldn't even imagine using other than just looking at. I am, and I want to let you know, I am exactly dumb enough to think that I could do that, which I see online. And I even went so far as to price these very beautiful Japanese-style joinery saws. Now, I'll tell you, of all the videos, Japanese joinery is absolutely my favorite. Everything is cut and shaved down with precision, so it all just fits together perfectly. It's no glue or no nails, just friction. And the weight of the whole enterprise holding it in place. It fits together perfectly. It's a master at work. And then here's me with my sophomore bravado. I was told once that sophomore means wise fool, which is true because I know just enough to know that I really don't know all that much. But I think, hey, I can make the pieces fit together if I get all the right tools, right? If I get in the right workshop, if I have all the perfect just specimens of the best wood. And that's just what that guy does. If I do just what that guy does, just what the master does, then of course it will all work out. I have these designs in my head about what it should look like. These precise manipulations, maybe. If I just move this piece and remove that one, if I pair this one over here with this one over there, if I shave off just these few rough bits and affix it to this one, then if I do it all right, then it will work out just perfectly. If I do it all right, then it will all hold up together simply by being in the right place for the right purpose. As metaphors go, maybe you can tell I really like this one. But do you agree with me? Well, maybe more in a second, right? But as metaphors for sermons go that intend to kick off a year-long all-church initiative that aims to place our togetherness in Christ front and center, as metaphors go like that, I think there's something to be said for the idea that the strongest glue or the deepest nails or the tightest screws that are intended to keep us all together are actually none of those things at all. I think there's something to be said that this whole project is held together by a kind of friction and the collective weight of the whole thing resting on each and every piece that has just been masterfully assembled. And since we're clearly now just talking about the church and not some end table, it's 100% worth saying explicitly that if you were to let me be the one in charge of this, if you were to let me build it, if you were to make me the Noah of this particular ark, then I'm gonna tell you right now, get your floaties ready, because I'm gonna mess it up. I am a sophomore par excellence. And you are too, I have to believe. We all are. I've got ideas. You've got ideas. I've got ideas about where we're going to do and where we're going to go and how we should be. But like the proverbial Noah, you got to put your ideas in the water and then we'll find out who's right. 2021, one body, many members. This will be our undertaking for this new year. It's going to be a way of looking at absolutely everything we do, from mission to membership, from Christian education to young at heart, stewardship, fellowship, and certainly from me. 2021 was born out of our Better Together campaign from this last year, 2020, and I'm going to borrow from the Noah idea again to say that these two, 2021 and Better Together, are like two by two. It's like a pair. It's like two of every kind. God calls them both together to get above the ark, and the goal has been the same ever since then. It's community. Community and never being alone here in the vessel that is our deliverance, that's designed by a master builder, that we've been entrusted with its construction, with the express purpose of keeping us from drowning when the water starts rising. You know, as Presbyterians, we believe in one God, one Lord, one baptism. And that's why we begin today. 2021 begins today, 10 days after the new year, because this is Baptism of the Lord Sunday. It's one God who forms us, one Lord who saves us, one baptism just as Christ, where you and I are claimed as God's own. Jesus is baptized by John, but John didn't invent baptism, mind you. There's this glimmer in the Gospel of Matthew's story where John seems to think that perhaps it's his job to make baptism what it is, to keep it holy, to keep it sacred, to hold it together. The Gospel of Matthew tells us that Jesus came from Galilee to John of the Jordan to be baptized him, but John would have prevented him saying, I need to be baptized by you, and yet you come to me. Matthew's John the Baptist looks and acts just like ours does from Mark's, but there's this moment's hesitation. Or he pauses and he wonders, he considers if this is the way it should be. Me baptizing him? John's inner monologue. John is fulfilling one of the most fundamental, one of the most consequential, one of the most important moments in the life of Christ and now in the life of the church, echoing thousands of years later, the very act that we have practiced to bind one another together. To the one God, to the one Lord for generations. And I'll tell you, I've never once felt more related to John than in this moment. Because there he is at the River Jordan and the waters of baptism. Jesus Christ is practically in his arms, surrounded by the heavenly host. And John pauses and wonders, am I doing this right? So let me ask you, friends, are we doing this right? One God, one Lord, one baptism. That's what we believe. But when it comes to living all this out, when it comes to being a church, are we doing this right? Can we look at our confirmation kids in the face? Can we stand before the lifelong member at the grave? Can we navigate the complexities of this so-called unintended consequences of success, which by that I mean the size of our church, knowing that because some hundreds of people call this place home, there are hundreds of different perspectives and hundreds of different experiences that all come to church on Sunday, that all read the newsletter each and every month. Are we doing this right if we decide that being welcoming to every conceivable configuration of the human experience is the most important thing? Are we doing this right if welcoming is code for comfortable, and comfortable is code for unchallenging, and unchallenging is code for simply just never broaching topics where people could possibly disagree? Are we doing this right if we go the other direction, though, and opt to make sure that every position is known on every issue so you can tell within minutes if you are indeed part of the same team? I was convicted recently that I use that phrase, we're all part of the same team a lot. But I've decided to stop, I'll tell you, because it simply isn't true. We're not all part of the same team. And if I try with all my might to make it so, What I'm sure of is this, that I will fail and it will have unintended consequences. Friends, Wauwatosa Presbyterian Church is a wonderful community. It's made that way because of people like you who call this place their own. But make no mistake, we're not united. We're not in the ways, at least not in the ways that we're taught to count. You know, data suggests that these days folks will point to their political and social and economic and geographical markers for showing the world who they are more than they'll point to just about anything else, more certainly than they'll point to their own faith. It's a natural byproduct of the world we live in, a world which says that if I'm ABC, then you are either ABC or you're 1, 2, 3, which is another way of saying you're either like me or you're not. And we've gotten very comfortable with deciding that being like me or not like me tells us absolutely everything in the world worth knowing. I grew up, as many of you know, in California. And you might have heard me say from time to time that when it came to people I knew in California who owned guns, there were only ever in two categories. There were police officers and there were wackos. Now, that served me well growing up in the Silicon Valley, but I went to college in Eastern Washington. I took a church in West Central Pennsylvania, in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania. The first day of buck season, the first day of deer hunting season in Punxsutawney was a school holiday. They shut it down. And it became pretty clear to me that if I divided the world between those who owned guns and those who didn't, and those who were like me, those who owned guns and those who were like me, despite the fact that most of my congregation there in Punxsutawney owned guns, most of my congregation hunted, or they had so for generations, or they'd been passed down to this lineage and this heritage, this from a parent to a child, much like the very faith that brought them into the sanctuary where I got to know them. And don't get me wrong, deer hunting and Christianity are not equivalents, but what we learn in the baptism story and what we learn in practicing and celebrating baptism has to be that anything other than one God, one Lord, one baptism is either or, and of our own making. It's a way of dividing along our own lines. It's like saying, if the church is only for those who agree with me, or who only agree with you, or with anybody, then it isn't a church. What is it? It's an idol. It's true. You know, 2021 is, and a lot is changing. And a lot will continue to change. And some things stay the same, mercifully so. There are solid rocks, and they're preferable to shifting sands. But one of the solid rocks that clefts for us all is simply that when it comes down to it, whatever floats down our pike this year and all the years that we've been together, unity that holds us together, unity is Christ's job. Not ours. Our unity, our oneness is always first in Christ. Our unity is first found in the bonds of God's love that extends far beyond your or my ability to navigate it. So 2021 isn't about being this on that single team of those of us who agree. That's an idol and a surefire way that will drive us apart, but intentionally, purposefully experimenting with the singular truth that disagreement over big and small things is never capable of endangering the unity that's found in Christ. The kind of unity I want to experiment with this year is perhaps something better we could just call holy disunity. Because we're not on the same team, we're not equal in every way, and if we've shown folks that the only way to be here is to leave something of themselves at the door so they could come sit in the sanctuary, then all we will ever get of the so-called unity is just fragile and brittle experiences of community. If we don't embrace our holy disunity as a sign that the church is already knit together, then we should expect that the only result will be a family of faith for those who are in the same boat, in the same position, as whoever is in power decides to go. You know, I heard a pastor remark once that 1/3 of the entire New Testament was dedicated to conflicts that bubbled up when folks like you and me tried to be both themselves and be part of the church as Christ instructed. Now, most of that one third comes from the Apostle Paul and his advice about conflict and community and living authentically among those who differ in really real ways can kind of be condensed and boiled down to simply this. Be united to one another the same way that Christ is united with you. In other words, friends, you and I need to adopt the same attitude to others as Christ has towards us. Authenticity, grace, mercy, respect, and most of all, love that binds us together but blinds us to the ways of the world. It's going back to that woodworking metaphor one more time. Because we're being held together by not ramrodding nails or driving fasteners or gluing us together. But it's really, truly the fact that we're held together by the friction that is the hallmark of a master designer who puts us next to each other and entrusts the entire weight of the project upon us, knowing that we won't crumble, but we'll be held together. So for these next few weeks, then throughout the year, you and I are going to be looking and listening and experiencing the kind of oneness I hope that Paul describes, the kind of oneness I hope that we find in Christ's baptism, the oneness that breaks borders and barriers without pretending that they don't exist, or the kind of oneness that doesn't think that every ditch is worth dying in. We'll hear a lot about the Christ who creates the big tent for all the faithful to fit under, and has lots of room for the kinds of holy disunity that has refined and that has reworked churches like ours for generations. But as we go through 2021 together, I'm inviting you to commit with me to three things. Number one, friends, please stay together and live out God's grace. You are a blessing to me. And yet if we fracture, it's a failure of grace, not of Christ. Number two, I want you to passionately share your own place and view in the world, knowing that if I disagree with you, I will first and foremost seek to do that through the lens of our unity in Christ. And then I want you to consider this, a piece that I found from the founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley. I love this beautiful language, and we'll end it with this. He writes, "Is your heart right as my heart is with yours? I ask no further questions. If it is, give me your hand. For opinions or terms, let us not destroy the work of God. Do you love and serve God? It is enough. I give you my right hand in fellowship." Friends, to the new year, thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, you might have noticed that I stayed away as best I could from the events of the week in the sermon. We could talk about it. I could talk about it for sure. You could too, I'm sure, but it's how that I'm most interested in. In some respects, it would be easy using those $5 words that we hear on television and in news reports. Using those $5 words may cost me your ear. It might cost the body of Christ your partnership. It may be even your membership. I say that because it's happened. It will continue to happen. It's the cost of being a group of people who voluntarily gather and call themselves a community. At any point, anyone can leave for any reason they choose. It's not a hypothetical situation, mind you. This happens all the time. But on the other hand, it's really hard. Really, really hard to talk about the events of the day and whatever they are, and not just this week. It's hard to talk about what we see going around us and say something in a way that could not be counted, could not be construed as divisive, as in dividing between those whose heads will nod and those whose heads will shake. That also happens all the time in our communities, in our homes, in our families, and certainly in our churches. That's why I wanted to address things in prayer today. And I'm reminded of the words of the psalmist who says, "But when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me to be a wearisome task until I went to the sanctuary of God, and then I perceived their end." There's nothing in this world of ours that isn't part of our prayer life, friends, or should be. We might use differing words and vocabulary here in this moment, a differing set of descriptions that have been born out of our lives' experiences, but there isn't a single one of us that isn't called to pray. Called to pray for the very same things that Christ prayed for. And in prayer, seek not only to pray for the world, but to pray for ourselves and be refined and see clearly, more clearly than before. I believe every prayer changes the world, and if in no other way, that every prayer changes those who pray it. Changes you and me. So in that truth, to that end, friends, I invite you, both for the world and for ourselves, will you pray with me? Holy One, we are not certain of what we saw this week. Frames of reference are fleeting. Images of mayhem set against our cherished symbols of civic hope don't make sense. Malevolent mobs revealed in the fragility of a union we prayed would hold under the strains of both politics and plagues. The blissful privilege of our civic naivete is gone. Such is not a partisan problem, but a community stain. Who was glad at the events of the day? Let them now confess and be forgiven. We pray, Lord, in your mercy, say for what we cannot yet express. Our fears of hope diminished, our worried that this is just the beginning, our prayers for leaders in this moment, our petitions for peace, our convictions that you make all things new. There are prayers for the pandemic, now considered by some to be an endemic contention that we will remain with us year after year. We remember those whose lives have been lost, who have lost something of themselves, who are wrestling under the weight of life here and now. We remember the places of our own heart, not usually featured on a television screen, but they break nonetheless, O Lord. We pray for those without a sense of hope or home or help, for those who struggle with everyday life, for those unable to get what they need, and for those who confuse what they want with what they need, and they pay dearly, O Lord, both literally and metaphorically for that equivocation. So we pray, find us in the midst of your world and let us hear your voice as the one who emerges out of the depths to a new completeness and purpose. Find us in the midst of our prayers and refine us, we pray. Today we name before you now those who have been on and placed on our collective minds, those who are experiencing life's transitions and the residents of nursing care facilities. We pray for those affected by illness, our students, our medical professionals, and the members and friends of this congregation. We name before you now Deidre Abbott and the family of Catherine Buck, who is Kim Slaughterback's mother. We pray for Jay Costello, Bob Detzer, Virginia Doherty, Norma Fernhaber, John Freed, Pat Hansen, Teresa Hosica, Jean Larson, Pauline Kilhefner, the Nysack and Wolf family, John Krugler, Paul Malmstrom, Dave and Mary Roberts, Faith Rhodes, Bina and her family, John Tagg, Mira Vebekar, and Roy Wetter. We also pray for the members of Narcotics Anonymous and other support groups who are unable to meet in person during this time. We pray for those incarcerated and for the prayers that continue to be submitted through our community prayer box. And so as we continue in prayer, let us together pray the prayer that Christ gave the church.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, thank you for joining with us today in worship. We are glad that you've been here with us, and we're glad that you will go out into the world this week seeking to foster unity in this new year, 2021. We are one body, many members. You're invited this week and all the days to come to participate into the life of the church, to bind ourselves together, to seek community how we can safely here and now. Friends, we are better together. We are the body of Christ. Our unity is found in Christ alone, and for that we say thanks be to God. So friends, may the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit and the example of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, be with you now and always, friends. Go in God's peace. Amen.